This is Apollo Control at 27 hours. Apollo 11's distance now 110,198 nautical miles. Velocity 4,984 feet per second.
11, this is Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Roger, for cryo-balancing purposes, we'd like you to turn the heater in oxygen tank number one off at this time, over.
Okay, stand by.
Everything else in the cryo system remains the same.
Okay. Okay, we have O2 heater tank one off.
Houston, roger out.
This is Apollo Control at 27 hours, 7 minutes. The crew is now in the process.
Is he happy with all those good things?
Oh, ECOM is happy, and after you get PTC set up, we've got a little procedure from ECOM here to check out the O2 flow and O2 flow sensor and your cabin enrichment, over.
Okay. It'll be a while, Bruce. We're just now arriving in PTC attitude, and we're going to our 20 minute of monitoring thruster activity.
Roger, we copy. He'll be here. This is Apollo Control, the passive thermal control being reestablished by Apollo 11 is at the rate of 3/10 of a degree per second, which would be 3 rotations per hour.
Houston, Apollo 11, you're going to take control of the Omni now and switch us between B and D.
This is Houston, standby one. Bravo at this time, and I'll give you a comm configuration here shortly.
Okay. PTC sure worked well last night.
Outstanding. Houston.
Go ahead.
Okay, well, for the comm situation, have S-band antenna Omni A and Bravo, S-band antenna Omni to Omni, high gain track to manual, and the pitch is minus 50 and yaw is 270.
Some of that there, James.
We got a
Lem guy taking care of the high gain right now.
Yeah, and he's eyeballing
there. He's
got his head out the window.
I understand. I had trouble on 12 with him, too.
Say again what you like.
Okay, the S-band antenna Omni A switch to Bravo, which you have now, and S-band antenna Omni to the Omni position. And the high gain track to the manual position.
Manual.
And the pitch and yaw angles are minus 50 for pitch and yaw is 270.
Minus 50, 270.
That's Jim Lovell, the commander of the backup Apollo 11 crew, communicating with Apollo 11 at the present time. He also commanded the Gemini 12 flight, in which Buzz Aldrin was his pilot.
Brownish green that we have in the islands of the peninsula of Spain, over.
Roger, I understand that the Northern African Mediterranean area is fairly clear today, huh?
Right. Yeah, we see a bunch of roads with cars driving up and down, too.
Do you find that the monocular is any good to you, Buzz?
Yeah, it'd be nice if it had another order of magnitude power on it. It has a tendency to jiggle around a little bit, and you might want to have some sort of a bracket. I hate to use that word, though. Got an anti-cyclone going in the southern hemisphere, southeast of Brazil, and some. Well, the diameter of it must be over 2,000 miles across.
How does the weather look up in the southern part of the Western Hemisphere, or up in the United States area?
Well, y'all are just beginning to come over the limb now. I can see parts of Central America, and it looks to be fairly, fairly clear there. The islands in the Caribbean are beginning to come in, and oh, there are a few streaming lines of clouds. Looks like there's a system up to the off of Greenland that has some large cloud streamers extending back down to the southwest. The east coast of the U.S. is just coming into now, and it doesn't look too bad as I can see it right now. We may have some pretty good shots later on this afternoon, over.
Roger, thank you.
That was Buzz Aldrin giving the description of what he could see on the Earth. The backup lunar module pilot, Fred Hayes, is also in the control center at the present time.
Houston, Apollo 11.
Go ahead, 11.
I got a comment about the point on the Earth where the sun's rays reflect back up toward us. In general, the color of the oceans is mostly uniform, and it's real bright, darker blue, except for that a region that's about 1/8 of an Earth radius in diameter. In this circular area, the blue of the water turns a grayish color. And I'm sure that's where the sun's rays are being reflected back on up toward us. Hello?
Roger, Buzz. We noticed the same thing. It's very similar to looking at a light shining on a something like a billiard ball or a bowling ball. You get this bright spot, and the blue of the water then turns into sort of a grayish color.
Is there a Navy term for that?
A lot of gray paint. 11 Houston.
Go ahead, Houston.
Mike, are you satisfied with P-23 now?
Yeah, I'm happy with the last updates we got, you know, in terms of what it did to our state vector. I'm still not altogether happy with the various procedures. If we could pick stars within the smaller range of trunnion angles so that you could allow P-23 to pick its own maneuver, go to that substellar point, and then have that star visible, that would, it seems to me, be the simplest and best way to do it.
How about the horizon now? Is it pretty well defined for you, no longer hazy?
Yeah, we're far enough out now that the I think the horizon definition variation is lost in the noise.
Go ahead, Buzz.
Looks like the best way to get a good steady view through the monoculars is just steady it out and let it float right in front of your eye, and then you kind of float up next to it, so that you're not touching it at all. It has a very slow drift, but you get a better, steadier view that way.
Sounds good. How does it feel to be airborne again, Buzz?
Well, I tell you, I've been having a ball floating around inside here, back and forth up one place and back to another. It's like being outside, except more comfortable.
A lot bigger than our last vehicle.
Yeah, I've been busy. I'm looking. Say again, my pleasure.
Yeah, it sure is nice in here.
I said it's a lot bigger than the last vehicle that Buzz and I were in.
Oh yeah, it's been nice. I've been very busy so far. I'm looking forward to taking the afternoon off. I've been cooking and sweeping and almost sewing and, well, you know, the usual little housekeeping things.
It was very convenient the way they put the food preparation system right next to the nav station.
Everything's right next to everything in this vehicle. Notice where the waste management is.
Tim, it's been a little warm in the machine throughout yesterday, and last night during the PTC, it cooled off somewhat with the windows buttoned up, and we've seen suit temperatures of about, oh, the high 40s, and cabin temperatures in the low 60s, but this seems to be still a little bit on the warm side.
I understand that it got a little warm during the day and cooled down a little bit when you put the shades up, but it's still a little bit warm. Do you have any moisture, condensation, or anything like that on the wall?
No, we haven't been able to detect any moisture any place in the spacecraft. It seems to be fine.
One of the hydrogen filters, the one that we've got on the hot water, seems to keep flowing when you remove one of the food bags from it. Its flow rate is quite small, right near the end of the 1 ounce. And that contributes a little bit of moisture to the atmosphere.
Yeah, I think on that hydrogen thing, it's... I'm not sure, but I think it's a back pressure problem. If the thing sees any back pressure at all, like when the bag is attached, well, the flow rate will slowly decrease to where it's it's almost zero, and you wait and you wait and you wait for that last ounce. You think you have it. You remove the bag, and then you very rapidly thereafter see maybe a glob the size of a dime or a quarter come out and just hang there. That appears to be true, even though the opening into the bag is not restricted.
Understand.
In general, it seems to do quite a good job, especially on the gun, and removing a lot of the hydrogen bubbles.
The water temperature's been good. Are you getting hot water?
Yeah, it seems reasonably warm.
Yeah, we made 3 cups of coffee today. The last one, when all the plumbing was warmed up, the hydrogen gun and everything was the warmest of the 3. And I don't know who had that one. Neil, you have that one? How was your coffee? You didn't drink it until later, did you? But anyway, it's pretty good. It's not piping hot, but it sure beats stone cold coffee. Jim, we've been sitting here a little over 20 minutes now. How does the thruster firing activity look? Are you ready to go on with this PTC?
Standby. We're all set to go, Mike.
Okay, I'll press on it. Thank you. Houston, Apollo 11, PTC is started and it looks good.
This is Houston, roger out.
This is Apollo Control at 27 hours, 46 minutes. Apollo 11's distance from the Earth is now 112,386 nautical miles, velocity 4,906 feet per second. We now have the actual numbers on the mid-course correction maneuver. Ignition time was 26 hours, 44 minutes, 57.92 seconds. Duration of the burn was 2.91 seconds. Delta V, 20.9 feet per second.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Roger, if you're free for a couple of minutes, we have a procedure here that will let us verify the O2 flow transducer and at the same time get some more of our cabin enrichment out of the way, over.
Stand by.
Roger, the primary purpose of this is, as I mentioned, to let us check out your O2 flow transducer. However, we still need about 2 hours worth of cabin enrichment, so we'd like to keep the vent that we're going to set up going for this purpose. Okay, we want you to install the cabin vent quick disconnect, which you'll find in compartment R6, that is Romeo 6, on the urine connector on panel 251. When this is completed, verify that the waste stowage vent valve is closed, and then open or position the waste management overboard drain to the dump position. Over.
Waste dump valve is closed and sink in the last part.
Roger. And then put the waste management overboard drain valve into the dump position. Over.
Roger. Put the waste management overboard drain valve to the dump position.
Right. That's one down on panel 251 also. And we'll watch your O2 flow on telemetry down here. This is Houston. Say again, please.
You do have the O2 flow transducer checkout setup accomplished.
Okay, understand you have opened the drain valve this time.
That's a firm. It's in zone.
Roger, we're not getting telemetry data from you right now due to low signal strength. There it comes back. I expect it will probably take us anywhere from 15 minutes to half an hour to see an increase in O2 flow due to the size of the cabin versus the small size of the drain. Over.
All right.
Go ahead, 11.
All right, I've got the world in my window for change, and looking at it through the binoculars, it's really something. I wish I could describe it properly, but the weather's very good. South America is coming around into view. I can see on the what appears to me to be upper horizon a point that must be just about Seattle, Washington, and then from there I can see all the way down to the southern tip, Tierra del Fuego, and the southern tip of the continent.
Now, Roger, it sounds like you've got a beautiful view up there.
Absolutely fantastic. I hope the pictures come out. Just, we're rotating around where it's going out of view again.
That's Mike Collins talking.
I'll pick it up in a second.
Sounds like one of these rotating restaurants.
And Bruce McCandless is back on the Capcom console now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Thank you.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Negative. We had a command computer at the Madrid site go down. We had to switch over to Ascension temporarily. We're now back remoting through Madrid, and the computer is back, and we're ready to resume control of the Omnis and full communication. Over.
Okay, you've got it.
Okay, one thing that we did miss in the dropout and the noise here is your LEM-CM Delta P reading for about 28 hours GET. Over.
Okay, the LEM-CM Delta P is 0.98.
Roger, 0.98, and what have you been reading for O2 flow on your onboard gauge? Over.
Well, right now, after we put that gadget in, we got him at 0.35. Before that, we were reading a scale low. I think ours is relatively correct, at least when time comes. Water accumulators kick in for 10 seconds where it goes on up to about 0.75, 0.8, something like that.
This is Houston, roger out. And 11, this is Houston. A little more information based on our analysis of your last SPS burn. It looks like you got a good solid burn there. We show 94 PSI chamber pressure, and it looks like the SPS is definitely go. Over.
Good to hear.
Ah, roger. We thought you'd feel that way about it.
We're right in the middle of, either orange paper zinc or salmon salad, something like that. That's probably why we're not answering you right away.
Okay, well, we don't want...
The columnist is a chef, but that salad salmon is outstanding.
Roger, understand that's the salad salmon, over?
Something like that, salmon salad.
There we go. Okay, the salmon salad. Very good.
Okay, Bruce, we're coming up on a water accumulator activity. And it's going on up to 0.85, about 0.95. And it reached a peak there and then gradually drops back on down at 0.6 now, 0.4. Looks like it's pretty well leveling off back down at 0.35, over.
Roger, we're copying that.
At 28 hours, 40 minutes, we're showing Apollo 11's distance as 114,922 nautical miles from Earth, velocity 4,819 feet per second. The crew is eating lunch at the present time, and sounds like there's some music in the background that they're enjoying during their lunch period.
11 Houston.
Go ahead.
Roger, on that O2 flow transducer, down here on telemetry, our values are agreeing pretty well. I'll put you red out on board, and the ECOMs have been noticing this cycle, but it still looks like the indicated rate is lower than what we would expect. We're still working on the problem, and we'll let you have a more complete diagnosis in a little while.
Okay, it's a tight ship. We run a tight ship.
Roger, is that music I hear in the background?
Buzz is singing.
Okay.
Pass me the sausage, man.
Thank you. choices.
This is Apollo Control at 29 hours into the mission. Apollo 11's distance from Earth is now 115,837 nautical miles, velocity 4,788 feet per second, spacecraft weight 96,117 pounds. This is Apollo Control at 29 hours, 20 minutes. Apollo 11's distance from the Earth is now 116,747 nautical miles. Velocity 4,758 feet per second. One of the clocks in the control center is now displaying the time to landing, the landing time being based on the time in the flight plan. It shows we're 73 hours, 26 minutes, 30 seconds from the lunar landing. Thank you.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Roger, 11, we've been watching your activity on the Disky there, and by selecting another major program with a Verb 37 enter and all that, we show you collapsing the dead band in PTC and having driven the CMC rate from 0.3 degrees per second down to 0 degrees per second, although, of course, with all the auto RCS coil shut off, you're not firing any thrusters, over.
Okay, what do you recommend?
Well, you just continue in your present configuration in PTC. However, if you go to turn any thrusters on, the CMC would then try to bring you into an attitude hold position rather than continuing with PTC. Over.
Roger, I understand.
Okay.
And Houston, we're just looking at you out our window here. Looks like there's a circulation of clouds that just moved east of Houston over the Gulf and Florida area. Did that have any rain in it this morning?
Roger, a report from outside says that it's raining out here, and looks like you got a pretty good eye for the weather there.
Yeah, well, it looks like it ought to clear up pretty soon from our viewpoint. It's the western edge of the weather isn't very far west of you.
Okay.
That was Neil Armstrong.
I can't.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
11, this is Houston. As a result of our venting through the waste management drain, why we've concluded that your O2 flow rate sensor is in fact malfunctioning. I mentioned when you talked us through the cyclic water accumulator dump that even though it was moving up and indicating a higher flow rate, it didn't seem to be indicating a flow rate that's high enough. And based on that and the flow that we're getting right now, we've concluded that the transducer is malfunctioning. We'd like to continue the O2 flow for about another hour, shutting it off at about 31 hours GET to get the O2 concentration in the vehicles up to where it'll be acceptable for a limb checkout. Over.
Okay, does it look to you like it just has a BIOS on it?
Roger, 11, it does seem to be a BIOS. Looks like it has a fairly high threshold before it starts indicating. Ecom seems to think, though, that for high flow rate purposes, it'll still give you a relative indication during the mission. Over.
Okay, we understand. Thank you.